We want to thank God for that special music. We're going to sing our theme song, Want Never Thirst Again, before Brother Douglin comes on. Please stand. Please, the youth between ages 12 to 19 are asked to assemble under the tent below with Brother Prince Charles. Youth, please assemble below with Brother Prince Charles. Thank you.
Good afternoon to everyone. Hope you had a very good day so far. We are going to be continuing with the covenants now and finish off the covenants. And don't forget, I have a quiz for you, and all who get full marks will get a special reward. The quiz won't be coming today, but I, as regards when it is coming after today. Now, let me give you a rundown of the timetable for this evening. After this lecture, we're going to our discussion period, and the discussion topic is, we're focusing on one discussion topic this afternoon. It is this: Reformation groups in the Caribbean. What must be the foundation of true Reformation in Adventism? And two, what are the biblical guidelines for Reformation unity in the region? You have a topic for discussion? Reformation, Seventh-day Adventist Reformation groups in the Caribbean. What must be the foundation of true Reformation? One, and two, biblical guidelines for Reformation unity. And I will coordinate tomorrow evening. Someone else will coordinate, but tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, we're going to be dealing with the same subject. So we're doing it locally here. And tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, we're going to do it on the, well, you know the technological terms, people in America will link up with us on telecom or Skype, video, what do you call it? By ear, through the ear. Praise the Lord. By satellite and ear, okay? All right. But later on, we still have to come back to some delicate subjects. There are people who want to hear about the 24 elders and what or who they are and a few other doctrine. Religious liberty, we still have to tie off a few ends there because there seem to be some among us who feel that we should tell the state to run the country by the Bible. So therefore, Reformation principles, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, A.T. Jones, it is obvious that Adventists don't know those principles. We can't be like the other Christians, the Protestants, wanting to form an image of the beast. The state must remain secular. Bible and morality is church, the individual and his conscience. When we start wanting the state to make the nation a religious nation, the question is, which religion will it make it? And the minority will always be persecuted. So all these principles we have to tie up before camp finishes. A lot of work ahead. Today's day number, which day this is? Day number 5. And we have Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Sabbath. We're looking at something for Sunday in terms of something sociable. But we'll have to work it out with the financial authorities. Let us pray. Gracious Father, be with us now as we go into this session, completing our study of the very serious subject called the covenants. Teach us and guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Covenants are very important. Very important. And you talk to Adventists, you talk to people who claim they're Reformation, and if you hear people saying that there's no real difference between the old and new covenant, it means that person or those persons have not read the light on the covenants that God said Dr. Wagner brought and that he said he had the true light. It is a wonderful thing to be a Seventh-day Adventist, isn't it? Because we had a prophetess, and we have to be careful. Imagine U.S. Smith alive, And the prophetess tells U.S. Smith, the Lord has shown me that Dr. Wagner has the true light on the covenants. And the prophetess could be talking to a tree. Smith a move. So we today know, knowing that the prophetess is dead, are we still hold to the Smith Butler line? Are we any better off than Smith? We're worse off because we do all the light that came after that. So we have to be sure that we understand this history of the covenants, what the covenants really are, what the truth of the covenants is, and don't drift along with philosophies and our own opinions, because this doctrine of the covenants is a very important doctrine. Okay, so we open back now to where we left off. We left off at the letter that she sent to Uriah Smith. So we ended on page 69. This letter is also found in Selected Messages, Book 1, page 235. A very serious letter. And look at it, contains the character of God nucleus right there. We are not to regard God as waiting to punish the sinner for his sin. The sinner brings the punishment upon himself. And this ties in with great controversy. Page 36. God does not stand toward the transgressor as the executioner of the sentence, but leaves the rejecters of his mercy to reap what they have sown. Okay. So we go now to page 70. And we start at the top of page 70. So top of page 70, moreover, a true understanding of the moral law reveals the gospel in the law, because God began by stating what he had done for them in Exodus 22. Now, okay, I have A.T. Jones' article in Galatians I'm going to share with you in this session as well to make things very clear. All right, the Sinai covenant. Now, this is the covenant that gives people trouble. The Sinaitic covenant, called the Old Covenant. People believe that God formed that covenant. So we're going to deal with this covenant very carefully now. The 1888 reformers, everybody following? Showed clearly that the Apostle Paul was the inspired master theologian on the correct interpretation of the covenants. Who is the master theologian for interpreting the covenants? Paul. Their key text to the understanding of the Old Covenant was Hebrews chapter 8, verses 6, 7, and 8. Let's read it. Hebrews 8, 6, 7, and 8. Open your Bibles there. Hebrews 8. Hebrews 8. Everybody has Hebrews 8? Everybody has it? Okay. Let's read it together. Hebrews 8, 6 to 8. And then we can read on 9 and 10. Let's go. But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is better covenant, which was established upon better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with them, he said, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Pause. Now, this text had been written by the Apostle Paul almost 2,000 years ago, eh? So it was in the Bible a long time. Men would read that passage with their eyes open and their visual cortex shut. You know, you don't see with your eyes, you know, you see with your brain. And the part of the brain you see with is right here, so the visual cortex. So if I trouble your visual cortex, you can't see. You see through your eyes with your brain. You do everything with your brain. You speak through your mouth by your brain. You hear through your ears with your brain. Your brain is what does this stuff. So you can open the Bible and start reading words. And if the brain isn't interpreting correctly, you can read that text for 2,000 years. That text was the Bible for 2,000 years. And when Jones and Wagner started dealing with this text, Smith and Butler didn't have a clue. Listen carefully now. The problem with the first or Sinaitic or Old Covenant was that it was faulty. You just read it on the text? Did you just read it on the text? It was faulty. The covenant at Sinai was faulty. Okay. And the fault was in the people, because the text says, for finding fault with them. So the covenant at Sinai, the Old Covenant, the first covenant, the Sinaitic covenant, was faulty. The fault was with the people. Okay? Watch it carefully. The problem with the first or Sinaitic covenant, Old Covenant, was that it was faulty. And the fault with the people had to be their own promises, because the new covenant is established on better promises. So in a flash, under inspiration, Wagner saw that the Old Covenant was faulty. The fault was that the people had made promises that they could not keep. Everybody following? Everybody following what the Apostle Paul said? Pretty clear. Next paragraph. So what really happened at Sinai? We can read Exodus 19, verses 1 to 5. You have your Bibles? Exodus 19, 1 to 5. And when you find Exodus 19, 1 to 5. Well, you find Exodus 19, 1 to 5. Listen to A.T. Jones, the other reformer, in Review and Herald on Galatians. Review and Herald comments on Galatians, June 12, 1900. Listen to this statement by A.T. Jones. When God approached Moses in Egypt to bring the Israelites out, the promise that God quoted to them was the covenant that God quoted to them, the promise, was the covenant he had made with Abraham long before. And God told them, I am the God of Abraham, Jacob, Isaac, Jacob. I'm going to bring you out because of my promise to Abraham. So God brought them out of Egypt under the new covenant, which is the only covenant God made. Only covenant God made, because God won't make anything faulty. Okay? Only covenant God made. Listen to A.T. Jones. In Exodus 6, 2 to 8, God spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am the Lord, and I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob, by the name of God Almighty, but by my name Jehovah or Yahweh was I not known to them. Then God goes on to say, and I have also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage, wherein they were strangers. And I have also heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage, and I have remembered my covenant. Wherefore say unto the children of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will rid you out of their bondage, and I will redeem you with a stretched out arm and with great judgments, and I will take you to me for a people. I will be to you a God which bringeth you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will bring you into the land concerning which I did swear to give it to Abraham. Exodus 6:2-8. I will give it to you for an heritage. What covenant was God quoting when he was telling them in Egypt, I'm about to deliver you because I've remembered the promise I made to Abraham? What covenant? The new. So God brought them out of Egypt under which covenant? The new. Therefore, was there any need for any other covenant? No. But this is the point that we're going to establish earlier clock. Hope you're following. It's a very important light that Dr. Wagner brought. Very serious light. Exodus. That was Exodus 6:2-8. Okay, back to the book now. So I hope you're following. God brought them out of Egypt by the Abrahamic covenant, the only covenant God had ever made. It's called the new covenant, called the Abrahamic covenant, called the second covenant, whatever you want to call it. It's the only covenant. The best name for it is the everlasting covenant. Okay. So he brought them out. Now, except for when Abraham lapsed into the old covenant with Hagar, minding his wife's advice. Don't look at me, so Sister Neola. Except for when he lapsed, you ever heard Abraham complaining and murmuring and fretting? But Israel coming out from Egypt, they come through the Red Sea. All this is the strength of God's promise in the new covenant, come through the Red Sea. And the moment they set out, now what happened? You bring us out to Egypt and we ain't got no water. You bring us out to Egypt and we ain't got no food. You bring us out to Egypt and we ain't got this in the nets. Would to God we were still in Egypt. We at least get some food or we get licks. Well. There's something. Whew. You think it's easy to deal with these ants? It ain't easy. Moses was said to be the meekest man. And even he lost his temper one day and didn't enter the promised land. So you see what people can do to their leadership when they behave that way? Prevent them from entering the promised land. That's a serious thing. And the Israelites didn't even care. Didn't even care. Fret, murmur, all sorts of things. Ellen White has a statement that I have in this camp book here. She said there are some people who are always complaining. If God ever take them to heaven, they will complain about how God runs heaven. Let me read it to you later on. And she said there are some people who demand their own way over their brethren, and if they go to heaven, they will want to run heaven according to their own way too. Serious statements. Murmuring, fretting, and demanding your own way. A serious thing. A chap told me that a man met him one day and told him, "Wait, I hear your wife has called all the shots in the house." The man said to him, "And what does your wife do?" He said, "Ashamed to tell, she's gone." He said, "Well, at least I got one." This man was not coming to fret and complain and laugh at the man. The man was not a complaining man, but this man was complaining. In every situation, you will have difficulties. There is no situation in this imperfect earth in which you won't have difficulties. But when we are surrendered to the Lord and practice Sabbath rest principles, we can let the Lord work it out. Okay? So the children of Israel. Now answer me this question. When the children of Israel start complaining about everything, tell me this, answer me this before we get back to the note. What does that tell you about their remaining in the new covenant? What's the new covenant? Believing the promise of God. You mean God come in Egypt and tell Moses, tell the people, I am the Lord God Almighty. Let me give you my name now. I am Jehovah Yahweh. And I am remembering my promise to Abraham, and I will the land that I promised Abraham. That's the promise of God. And as soon as you set foot off the Red Sea, you start complaining, which means you don't believe the promise. And the moment you don't believe the promise, you have departed from the covenant. You got that clear? So God brought them out in the new covenant. And by their murmuring and fretting and complaining, it showed that they had lost faith in God and his promises. And therefore, they were on a different path. Let's continue now. Hope that is clear. Good. If you read Exodus 19, verses 1 to 5, again, Wagner's point was that the only covenant God could have been referring to in Exodus 19 was the covenant that was already in existence, the one he had made with Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, which is the everlasting covenant. In other words, God was seeking to renew the Abrahamic covenant with Abraham's physical children when they got to Sinai. Now, God realized, somebody read Exodus 19, 1 to 5 for me, please. But God realized that they having forsook the only covenant, God was about to renew the new covenant with them. Because God only deals with one covenant. God only makes one covenant. So what God was about to, I tell you something, God is a wonderful God. So read Exodus 19, 1 to 5, please.
Thanks.
Go ahead.
Thanks, stop. In the third month, when the children of Israel were gone forth out of the land of Egypt, the same day came they into the wilderness of Sinai. Thank you. Sorry. For they were departed from Rephidim and were come into the desert of Sinai, which had pitched in the wilderness. And there Israel camped before the mount. And the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, Thus thou shalt say to the Lord of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians. Thank you.
And how I bear you
on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself. Now, therefore, if ye obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine.
So God told them, look, you see what I did unto the Egyptians? If you will obey my voice, the Hebrew is, if you will listen to me. Listen to me, hear my promises, hear my voice, and obey my covenant. Now, what was the only covenant in existence at that point in time? The Abrahamic covenant. So God was inviting them to get back into loyalty of believing his promises. Are you with me? So listen to Wagner. In other words, God was seeking to renew the Abrahamic covenant with Abraham's physical children. Next paragraph. But what was their response? Now, this is the key. This is the point that Smith and Butler couldn't follow and that the Adventist world is still in confusion on because they rejected the light that was sent. Listen carefully. What was the response? They promised to do all that God has spoken. Exodus 19:8. All that the Lord have said, we will do. God then spoke and wrote the Ten Commandments and also gave certain civil statutes to Moses for them. And again, what was their response? Exodus 24:3, they made their second promise. They again promised to do all that the Lord had said. Next paragraph. Remember Abraham? When God made his promises to Abraham did not promise to do anything. He simply believed God, and his faith was counted for righteousness, and his faith worked by love enabling him to obey God through the righteousness of Christ. So it was genuine heart obedience because he had the love of God and trusted that God, surrendered to that God who gave him the gift of righteousness and motivated him by his love. In other words, the promise did everything for Abraham when Abraham, by faith, received it. Are you with me? So watch the trick now. This is the point that the theologians miss. At Sinai then, the Israelites, this paragraph is very important. At Sinai then, the Israelites, rather than renew the Abrahamic covenant by faith, follow carefully everybody, formed or made by unbelief the old covenant in which there is no savior, no forgiveness of sins. It was obey and live or disobey and die. They promised to do what they could never get done without the savior promised in the Abrahamic covenant. Paul summarizes it in Romans 10:3. What does Paul say in Romans 10:3? For they, Romans 10:3, Romans 10:1 to 4, quickly. What does Paul say in Romans 10:1 to 4? That the Israelites had a zeal without knowledge and sought to establish their own righteousness and would not submit to the righteousness of God. Romans 10:1 to 4, Paul summarizing the old covenant. You follow? Rather than submit to God by believing his promise, they did not believe the promise of God and sought to establish their own righteousness by promising to obey. Am I promised to buy a ticket for you to fly you to China to see Sister Lilith when she's teaching up there? You don't have a cent. The man bought the ticket, everything's organized, passport, everything, even a visa for Communist China. The man said, I've done everything for you. Go and collect the ticket. You don't believe the man. And you go down by the port and ask which ship they sail to China you want to try and stow away because you ain't got no money. You want to work your way to China. You don't believe the promise of the man and what the man has done, so you know trying to get to China with a slow boat that can sink. And that's the old covenant. Let's go over that again. Very important. At last paragraph on page 70, at Sinai then the Israelites, rather than renew the Abrahamic covenant by faith, formed or made by unbelief, the old covenant, in which there was no savior, no forgiveness of sins. It was obey and live or disobey and die. They promised to do what they could never get done without the savior promise in the Abrahamic covenant. Read Romans 10:3 and understand what really happened. They sought to establish their own righteousness by their own obedience to law apart from Christ. That's the old covenant. So who formed the old covenant? Not God. The Israelites by their unbelief. And when Paul gets to the two children, as we should see a couple minutes from now, Paul explains it even more clearly again. It was not God that formed the old covenant, so the old covenant has no relationship to the new. It is not the new. The two are not the same. The Israelites formed the old covenant by promising to do what they could not get done when God was trying to get them to believe the Abrahamic promise. And that's what Wagner explained, and Smith and Butler would not believe it. And that is why the Adventist world is still confused with covenant. I still see quarterlies coming out saying that the old and new covenant is part of God's overall plan. See quarterlies coming out saying the two of them are the same. Quarterly up to 2000 and up to the year, this 21st century. Because ever since then, the light has not settled in Adventism because they rejected the 1888 message. Even that famous book by the three ABN people, and I'm not criticizing anybody, I'm just showing you how error is. That famous book, The Ten Commandments Rewritten or Written Twice, that famous book that we're advertising. Fairly good book, but when you open it now, no light on the covenants. They say the law in Galatians 3, they run down the same U.S. Smith line, is entirely the ceremonial law. I said, well, when the people reject light back there, and will not repent and accept it, they will talk real sweet, but talk real rubbish. I feel it's right, you know. So I tell you, Reformation is serious. We in Reformation have to be established upon truth. Okay? If not, we may as well shut down and go back into where we came from. We cannot be in error. Okay. All right, top of page 71. It should also be clear that the Old Covenant was not the Ten Commandment moral law per se, as some theologians say. It was the people's promise to obey that law apart from the promised Savior of the Abrahamic or New Covenant. But so attached to the written code did they become that the Old Covenant which they formed was equated with the written code of the Ten Commandments. So in fact, trying to obey a written code to get righteousness, that's the Old Covenant. The righteousness of God, the basis of his covenant. We're moving a little bit more quickly now. Only a couple more pages, but time moves fast when you're trying to explain. The righteousness of God, the basis of his covenant. God's righteousness must be the basis of his everlasting covenant. This righteousness was and is in the promise and the promised seed, Christ. Remember, Christ is the righteousness of God. Christ is our righteousness. When God gave his promise to Abraham, he gave his righteousness to Abraham, and Abraham received that righteousness as a free gift. As we saw in chapter 3 and 4, God's righteousness is Christ. The Ten Commandment moral law is a transcript of God's righteousness. It is God's righteousness expressed in human language. And God gave the moral law to show the Israelites their need of his living righteousness, that is, their need of Christ. Righteousness and life can never be extracted from a written code. The written code of the Ten Commandments was given to show them and us our sinfulness and to give us no reprieve until it brings us to Christ to receive him. This is the schoolmaster function of the law, which it performs today as well as in the pre-cross era. Moreover, it is vitally important to understand that since the Ten Commandment written code summarizes the righteousness of God, there can be no discrepancy between any of the Ten Commandments and the righteousness received in Christ. When Christ dwells in the believer's heart, the Ten Commandments will be kept. The Apostle Paul is clear on this point in Romans 8, 1-4, where he explains that in Christ, the righteousness of the law is fulfilled in the believer by being written, Hebrews 10:16, in the believer's heart. The promised inheritance. Everybody following? In Genesis 13:15, God told Abraham that all the land which his vision took in will be given to him and to his seed forever. The Apostle Paul interpreted the Genesis 13:15 inheritance in Romans 4:13 to mean the world. Paul says in Romans 4:13 that God promised Abraham the world. Well. Which world? The one to come. The earth made new. As we see, not so much as to set his foot on.
And therefore then it's a falsity with respect to claiming up in the Middle East that the land up there belongs to Israel.
Yes, that's nonsense. Israeli nation up there claiming land and fighting Palestinians and the Christian nations. We can come to that in religious liberty, though. That's an important point. Top of page 72, for the promise that he should be heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through law, but through the righteousness of faith. But Paul did not stop there. In Hebrews 11:10, Paul wrote that Abraham looked for the new Jerusalem. In other words, the promised inheritance is the earth made new, which Christ and his saints will possess after the millennium of Revelation 20. Hence, Wagner understood the statement in Galatians 3:19, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, to be speaking not of the first advent, but of the second and third advents of Jesus Christ as King of kings and Lord of lords, to possess and reign over the new heavens and the new earth. Therefore, Galatians 3:19, Wagner explained, does not teach that the functions of the law cease at the first advent, as the theologians in the world teach, but that those functions endure to the end of time. You see how revolutionary Wagner was? Everybody got that point? Read it over and make sure you get it. Because I still hear Adventists with that. You don't have it clear. Till the seed should come, they say it means the first advent. Wagner said, no, it means when Christ comes to get the promise, the new heavens and the new earth, which is the second or third comings. So this was revolutionary stuff. Paul's analysis of Abraham's two sons, Galatians 4, 21 and 31, 24 to 31. I can see some people are struggling. I know it is after lunch. The blood goes on to the stomach to digest. That means if you had more food, you'd be out cold. So thank the Lord for mercies. Thank the Lord for blessings. Abraham and Sarah had God's new covenant promises. Praise the Lord. Abraham and Sarah had what? God's new covenant promises. The central promise was the promise of a son. After what they considered a long wait, unbelief developed in Sarah's mind, and she suggested to Abraham a scheme by which he could obtain a son. Well, we talk about the man being the head of the woman. Okay? A chap once told me a little secret, though. A man said that's theology. That is wonderful theology, but it only works in the church. He said, the moment you get through the door, it ceases to exist. So that's another area for discussion. Now, here is the household of Abraham and Sarah. Abraham is the head of the house. So, why did it have to wait? What was God allowing them to wait for? God was waiting for their faith to reach the desired level. That's what God was waiting for. God wasn't just arbitrarily delaying. It was a miracle that called for faith. So God was waiting for their faith to develop. But lo and behold, while God was waiting for their faith to develop, they developed unbelief. And now, look at family issues. All down through the ages, okay? The woman is quick to suggest. And she does. Look, God don't understand women, you know. Abraham, sweetheart, let me talk. Come go in the bedroom, let me talk. I could have never get children. I know I'm getting old. You know, getting shaky. And the longer we wait, waiting on this God, the more difficult it can be impossible. So listen to me, Abraham. Don't mind, you're the head of the house. I can take charge of this situation now. Sounds familiar? Happens from then till now. I can take charge of this situation now. You got to listen to me. Because I'm the woman, and I know what's going on inside of me. The Lord, like you don't know, go into that young girl called Hagar and get a child before it get too late for me and you. And Abraham, don't put up your hand, Rosalind. And Abraham yielded to his wife's suggestion. I ain't saying anything wrong, so don't put up your hand. Abraham yielded to his, all that you saying, I saying. Abraham, of course. I say Abraham yielded. So don't say what he's saying. Abraham yielded to his wife's suggestion. Okay? All right. I said that deliberately to tickle people and wake them up. Everybody awake now. Not a soul sleeping. So see how minds work? Not a soul sleeping, now I touch the woman. Too sweet. All right, Brother Trotman? We move on. Tell Abraham, try and go and get a son from the young girl. Because God far away, and he ain't with it. He really ain't with it. You know the young people talk? God ain't with it. What's going on? Abraham chose to yield. You talk about free choice, you know, but that's how you boy. A man tell me, I was at a funeral and a man gave an eulogy. And he said that when his mother and his sister decide to put up rich curtains for Christmas, and he gone in the house and said, man, me, but you ain't consult none of these sons, nor the other three girls. The mother and the first girl say, consult. We put up these curtains tomorrow. All we want from you all is help. So the man said he was accustomed from early to the headship of the man in the house. It is on paper. Only by getting a eulogy, you know, is on paper. The church can break down. So, choice, of course, choice, you know. Come and help put up curtains. So Abraham, come and help get the baby. Everybody awake? Praise the Lord. No, soul sleeping. Good. Let's move on. So later on, paragraph 2, Abraham's and Sarah's faith in God's promise, praise the Lord, was restored. But before we get that paragraph, you know what happened? He went in to Hagar. How you felt that Abraham felt? Oh, did you say good? Everybody, you're really awake now. Oh, we say good. Well. Woo! Move on quick, boy. But soon there was trouble in the house. The same scheme that Sarah suggested to get the child. Now the child born. Guess what the Egyptian girl said? You could have never got a child free, my God, one, though. All these years, you can't get a child from me. You can send to the Lord, I got the boy. So woman against woman. And now you can see trouble. Now you can see headship. Sarah gone back to Abraham and said, she got to leave this house. She and the boy, they got to leave this house. They got to clear out. Abraham said, but good Lord, then you suggest it. You hear me say, Abraham, she got to leave this house. So Abraham exercising free choice all the time. So this time he said, look, I make a mistake just now. I listened to her. I'm asking the Lord. The Lord said, this time, you listen to her the wrong time, listen to her the right time. Now she must go. If you should have come to me the first time, the Lord would have told him, you should have come to me the first time. You ain't come. Now you're coming to me. Now she right. When she was wrong, you ain't come. Now she right. You're coming. They must go. So every family, Abraham's the father of the faithful, every family got troubles. All right? But don't let the troubles in the family run you to the old covenant, keeping the new. Trust the Lord, love, and forgive. Okay? A man tell me that anybody that tell him the family perfect is like that story. I get the young people. A Sunday school teacher had a Sunday school class of adults, not children, that would not read the Bible at all. So he said, look, I finished with this Sunday school class. This is the last chance. All 14 of y'all, read Luke 25 for me by next week, or I done. And next week he come back, he said, let me see the hands of those who read Luke 25, 6 hands gone up. Let me see the hands of those who didn't read. I said, well, we can be honest with you. Things were rough this week, we didn't read. You fine? Okay, it missed and it collapsed. So, he told the ones that said they didn't read, but at least they're all honest. He says that read Luke 25. Leave this class. Luke got 24 chapters. Luke has 24 chapters, you all read 25. Leave the class. Bunch of letters in your house of the Lord. So, there we have it. Now let's move on. Our next paragraph. We can finish this. In an amazing piece of inspired exegesis, the Apostle Paul tells us in Galatians 4:24 that the two births of the two sons, because remember, eventually their faith was restored, and the son of promise was born when Sarah was now twice dead. She was always barren. Now she wasn't even producing. She wasn't producing any eggs now she was when she was young. And now she's old. She can't produce none. So she's doubly dead. And Abraham was also dead. All right? So when nothing could happen, north, south, east, or west, God interposed at the 11th hour. His promise was no belief. They had no flesh to lean on. Whether you get a young girl or not, no Hagar could work this time. It was complete reliance on the promise of God. And they now believe God. And a son was born to Abraham when it was not possible to get a son. Praise the Lord. All right. He was reproductively incapacitated. Old age. How many years that was before? How many years? 13 years prior. 13 years prior. That's why. Listen, Austin. Sarah saw early signs, but there was still life. So he's telling him, before things get worse, get the young girl. By the time the 30 years passed, it was all over. You follow us, Sir Roslyn? You understand what I'm saying? Okay, a wife can't pick up Ben. Let's continue. Let's continue quick, bro. Y'all want to run me in trouble. Well, Sister Osmer said that. Sister Osmer is both a nurse, a mother, and everything she's saying. Yeah, what's this? Repeat it again, Sister Osborne.
These women know when a man is dead.
Let's move. Okay. So Sarah saw the earlier signs and said, go on quick, but get something going, get the old covenant going. You follow me, Brother Troy? Be clear. Okay. So now when it was all over and they could only depend on God, the promise came through, praise the Lord. Against three deaths, God brought forth life. A son was born. You follow me, sister? Good. Now, Paul is telling us that the birth of the two sons from the two women are the two covenants. The birth of Ishmael from Hagar was equivalent to the Sinai or Old Covenant and is a producer of bondage. And the birth of Isaac from Sarah was the New Covenant. So therefore, listen carefully. If Paul is telling us that the birth of Ishmael from Hagar is equal to the Sinai Covenant, we simply have to ask is what Wagner and Jones did, Paul did. How did Hagar and Ishmael get going? Because Abraham and Sarah, through unbelief, forsook the new covenant and devised a plan to get the son. Therefore, it must mean that the Sinai covenant was Israel forsaking the new covenant and devising a plan to get righteousness by their own self-effort to obey without the Savior. Clear cut? So the old covenant is legalism. It has nothing to do with the new. The two are not the same. It was not formed by God. It is outright legalism, and it can't work. And the reason, next chapter, the reason why there is Laodicean lukewarmness is because people don't understand that Laodicean lukewarmness is also old covenant. You come to that in next chapter. Now, we're just talking about how women can ask a question or make a suggestion and carry on another line and lick you up. Now, that question that is being asked by Sister Vashti is well known to Sister Joanne, she's down there laughing, and others in a particular discussion. So I will leave that for difficult issues to be dealt with in open discussion. Okay. Pardon? Don't worry with the question. Let's continue. The Hagar-Ishmael development was the result of unbelief in God's promise, which led to the Abraham-Sarah attempt to fulfill God's promise by their own works. Okay. Now, let me summarize this quickly. How did Ishmael look? They said that Ishmael was a strong, handsome, well-built man. What could be wrong with him? He was not the son of promise. He was the product of unbelief, the product of the old covenant. As we shall see too, so too, the church machinery for finishing the work looks real good. But it is not the product of faith in God's promise. it is in Ishmael. And what did God tell Abraham? Because when God came back, tell Abraham this same time that Sarah is going to get a baby, two things happened. Abraham said, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you. That's still the faith had to develop." And Sarah behind the tent door, what she did? Laugh. And then when the Son of God said, "Sarah, you are laughing at my promise." "I didn't laugh." "You did laugh." From that point on, Sarah went up in her faith. She realized now she wasn't toying with a joking God, a God whose promise could know that she was laughing behind the tent. Still laughing. Abraham's unbelief was expressed by his saying, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before me." And Sarah's unbelief was expressed by laughter. And from that point on now, they realized that they had better surrender and better believe and better trust God, because God had actually visited them. It was the Son of God who came down there, you know. The Son of God and the two covering cherub, Gabriel and the one whose name we don't know, passed them. What a wonderful thing, huh? All right, let's wrap it up now. We're going to go to the summary. So study the chapter. The quiz will surely come. Summary. The Abrahamic covenant was the new or everlasting covenant. It was God's promise of Christ. Christ is the new covenant. In him we have righteousness and rest, which will be manifested in obedience to the Ten Commandments and keeping the seventh day Sabbath. The Sinaitic covenant was the old covenant formed by the empty promises of the unbelieving Israelites at Mount Sinai. Throughout history, both before and after the cross, the new and old covenants have been and are conditions of the heart, either of faith or of unbelief, respectively. Over the page as we come to the end. The faith of Christ has set us free from the condemnation of sin, including the charge of the murder of the Son of God. Faith in him receives that freedom as a living experience, with the Holy Spirit reproducing his victory in the believer's character. Hallelujah. The texts are there. The new covenant is the everlasting gospel of justification by the faith of Jesus, to be experienced by faith in Jesus. Faith in Christ means abiding in Christ, and so long as the believer abides in Christ, victory over sin is guaranteed. The old covenant is the attempt of self to extract righteousness from a written code or any set of rules apart from Christ. It can never work. So look at this summary then. You should know this summary by heart. Old covenant and new. Old covenant in self, new covenant in Christ. Old covenant by the promise of self, new covenant by God's promise. Old covenant by the word of man, new covenant by God's word. Old covenant reckoned as debt owed for work done. Paul in Hebrews and Romans 4, new covenant by God's grace. Old covenant must be earned, new covenant, God's free gift. Old covenant by works, new covenant by faith. Old covenant by the flesh, new covenant by the Holy Spirit. Old covenant produces bondage to fear of death. New covenant produces freedom in love and righteousness. Old covenant, no real heart obedience. External obedience that looks good, but no real heart obedience. New covenant, genuine obedience. Old covenant, law written on stone. New covenant, law written in heart. Old covenant, self-righteousness. New covenant, Christ our righteousness. Old covenant, no rest. New covenant, Christ our rest. Old covenant, no forgiveness. New covenant, forgiveness full and free. Old covenant, the old only birth they know is the old birth. New covenant, the new birth. Old covenant, the inheritance is believed, point by the Austin Bid 10 minutes ago, believed to be Palestine and the earthly Jerusalem, which Israeli nation up there fighting for. In the new covenant, we know that the inheritance is the earth made new and the new Jerusalem. No comparison at all. Only contrast between the new covenant and old. Go over this chapter carefully. The quiz will come. Yes, sister. Microphone, please. But pause. Let's close off the section and go into the discussion section, and you can ask your questions and we'll continue on. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the study of the covenants. Grant that we all here will go over it thoroughly and know it thoroughly from the Bible and the Bible alone and what the Spirit of Prophecy has to say. It ties in with the Sunday Sabbath issue as well, as we have seen. Grant that we will know it thoroughly, not just for the quiz, but as part of our experience, to depend on your promises and to allow your Spirit to be the administrator of your church with Christ as the head in everything. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. All right, well, we go straight into our discussion period. And now you can ask any question. But although you can ask any question, I start out by saying we want to begin to focus this evening on a special subject. What is the subject again? Reformation, Seventh-day Adventist groups in the Caribbean. One, what must be the foundation for true reformation? And two, what are the biblical guidelines for unity in reformation? And the reason why there are reformation groups all around the world, the reason is that Seventh-day Adventism has rejected the 1888 message. And people who study and think for themselves realize that something is wrong with four generations of delay, and we want to get right with God. But why are we in Reformation no further advanced? Why are there problems in Reformation, and what can be done about them? You heard the topic? Okay. Now, while you get your thoughts together, let me just make a few points. Carefully. And these points are this. Listen to me carefully. The true Seventh-day Adventism is the true Christianity. We believe that. But there is in the Adventist world many versions of Adventism. And in the General Conference itself, the conference churches, there is ignorance of the 1888. Maybe go and ask the ordinary Adventist anywhere. Wagner Jones, never heard of him. 1888 message, we don't know. Covenants, Sister White said Dr. Wagner had the true light. We don't know anything about those things. So that Christ coming in sinful, fallen flesh and overcoming for us so as to implant his righteousness in us. All these things are unknown. If you raise them in the church, pastors don't preach them. The character of God, oh dear, well, that's murder. So this brings us to an important point. The basis of true Seventh-day Adventist Reformation, whether you're in a conference church or under a tree, because this isn't the place you worship, it is worshiping God in spirit and truth, must be a thorough knowledge of the 1888 message of righteousness by faith and seeking the experience by submitting to God in faith, claiming his promises. A thorough knowledge of the character of God message and seeking the reproduction in that character.